and welcome to Money, Money, Money. I'm Sumaira Abdi. Launched in 2009, Daan Utsav is celebrated every year between the 2nd and the 8th of October. The aim, to bring together Indians from all walks of life and social strata to celebrate giving. And if you're wondering what Daan Utsav has to do with personal finance, well, Gaurav Mashruwala is here to tell us why we need a holistic approach to finances as well as the joy of giving. Gaurav, thanks very much for joining us this week. And I know this is a topic that's also very close to your heart, right? So we've spoken about it on a lot of occasions. But, you know, as Indians, we are so used to taking from society, right? Over the years, you've taken a lot. But when it comes to giving, we're actually, the ratio is amongst the lowest in the world, right? So why is it that people like you and me actually need this approach to giving? Like, why is it so crucial for society, for individuals? And why does it matter for a person's personal finances?
So two things. One is that a lot of giving happens in a subtle manner, which probably does not get recognized or whatever. So, you know, people doing it in religious institutions or whatever, that doesn't happen, number one. Number two, also the country has much more amount of poverty, and hence below poverty line people are slightly higher. They are struggling for their ends to meet. So these are two reasons. One, it doesn't get officially noticed. It doesn't get recorded. And second, we have people living in poverty. So that's the reason it doesn't come up. Otherwise, charity or giving it back to society and community is what all scriptures have spoken about, daan and bhog. So, you know, one is that you consume for yourself and secondly, give it. In terms of personal finance, that kind of completes the entire circle. Because we only earn, our entire existence is because we take it from society, we take it from natural resources. Now, unless you don't give it back, how do this cycle continue? And if the cycle doesn't continue somewhere, we or our generations, later generations will struggle.
Yeah, a very wise man once said that, you know, someone's sitting under a tree, a shade today because somebody planted a tree many, many years ago. But how does one actually give? Okay, so I can choose to give a donation, which is actually non-monetary in its approach. One can do charity, which is more of a temporary relief or, you know, just action at the moment. And then there's philanthropy, right, which is more of a structural way to address the root cause of sort of leaving behind a legacy, etc. But what is appropriate and at what time?
So one is that if there are natural calamities, then you don't have time to create an institution or a charitable trust or just give away money, because that's the immediate need. If there's somebody critically ill, if there is somebody who needs to pay fees in a week's time, I mean, you're not going to go and say, oh, let me create a trust or let me go to do it immediately. There are some causes which are perpetual or which requires transformation. So you could be dealing with issues with women, or there could be illnesses, or there could be some environmental issues, which would require a situation whereby your money, your skills, your expertise, those needs to be kind of, you know, repaid, I would use, rather than just giving it away. And third is that you've reached a stage where you can create an institution and you can take a lot of people along with you who believes in the cause. Some of them are willing to give time, some of them are willing to give money, some of them are willing to give some other resources, and they all pool in for a particular cause. So depending on what is the need that a society or environment has, and where are you, at what stage of your income, what stage of your career, what is your frame of mind, you can choose, or you can be doing all three.
Yeah, the other misconception, Gaurav, is that you need to be wealthy to be a philanthropist. Is it really so? Can one really start something with small amounts of money?
Yeah.
And I don't mean donation or charity. I mean like actual philanthropy, which is round the year, you know, across someone's life stages.
So how about a SIP in philanthropy or SIP in donation or SIP in charity, either in form of money or time or resources? And the way you do SIP or recurring deposit every month, just set aside a fixed amount, fixed time and fixed resources that you will contribute every month, and it could be a smaller amount. A smaller SIP also grows into a wealthy asset base over a period of time. And same thing can happen here. So it doesn't matter how much you do it, it's how regularly and how disciplined manner you do it.
But if one is actually looking at smaller amounts, does it then make sense for a person to actually go to the rigmarole or the effort of forming, you know, charitable institutions, trusts, etc.? Or can philanthropy be done minus all of this and just through an already established NGO?
Yes, you are right, absolutely right, because the moment you set up an entity, a lot of issues come up, and which is fine. But then you're going to devote that much more time in terms of formation of trust, in terms of filing returns, PAN card, bank account, audits, etc. In the beginning, don't jump for that. In the beginning, you probably want to root it through some existing institution or just do it on your own. I know a particular couple. What they would do is that once every weekend, they would go to general wards of the hospital, pick up the prescriptions which would have been given to the patients, go outside, purchase medicine and give it to them. Now, you don't require an institution, you don't require anything, and they would say, okay, we will do it with five of them. I know one or two youngsters who would go to old age homes and say, okay, once a month we will go and read out newspapers to those elders. Now, that's a kind of activity which you can do. You don't really require money if you have to go and read the newspaper to it in an old age home. But you are inculcating those habits in you, you are getting familiar with that. Now, there are a lot many things that can be done for street children. Just go and play with them. There are a lot of institutions which makes toys library. So what they do is they collect toys, and there are a couple of toy libraries where you can give it away, or you go and give it to street children. Are you anyway going to throw it off because your kids have grown or they have multiple of them? But these are small things whereby the items that we have it in our house, which is just lying idle, we can use it. Or now we have all these places where you can sell it off. So sell off those, get money, and use it.
Yeah, actually, it depends on your area of interest and which way you actually want to be involved in it. But nevertheless, how can activities regarding giving or repaying to society actually be stepped up? I mean, you spoke earlier about how almost every religion has spoken about returning to society what you have taken, right? The due that you owe. How can it actually be stepped up? I mean, does it need to be formalized? Does one need to create more awareness? You know, you have festivals now like the Daan Utsav, etc. But how does one actually step up participation from individuals? I mean, how can they be jolted out of
it? Inculcates in childhood, which is very, very important. And it has to be part of the entire society and community, because that's when an individual is in that environment. So whatever environment that we are living in, that's where we are going to grow up, and that's what we are going to do it. But I feel at some point of time, even corporate houses, from the employees, give them options. So say from your salary, can we do small percentage or small amount which we deduct from your pay slip, and you have an options available, A, B, C, D, E, F, and you pick and choose, and we will just do it on your behalf. That's one way, and that's the best way. The way Provident Fund gets cut, maybe SIP gets cut, deducted, deduct this amount also. That's one way. And then encourage people to kind of take leave or whatever and go and work for. You know, a couple of organizations do that, where you go and, you know, work for those causes. Those are the ways that will slowly get back. Because if you want to reach masses, it's where masses go regularly, and that's where it's occupation or work.
Yeah, that's true. Actually, I mean, I think truer words weren't spoken. But let's take a very quick break on that note. When we come back, we'll tell you how you can actually go about selecting the right organizations that you want to donate to. Stay tuned. We'll be back in just a bit.